teaching of physics and also the cabinet of physics was kept at the Palazzo del Po, the historical building of the university. And so Bruno Rossi, you know, was a very brilliant, he was a physicist, he was one of the pioneers of cosmic ray research. When he left, he planned and built the new Institute of Physics here, and then in 1938, because of the racial laws, the racial fascist laws, he had to leave Italy, and then he made his career abroad, mainly at the MIT in Boston. I will show you one instrument which is kept here because it is too big to be kept in the Museum of the History of Physics, which we will see later. It is an electromagnet. So it is a 7 tons electromagnet. It was also, Bruno Rossi had it built for his experiments on cosmic rays, of course, and also he had started the construction of a 1 million volt accelerator, a Cockcroft-Walton accelerator in the Department of Physics, and so he wanted to use this electromagnet with the accelerator and for cosmic rays. But then he had to leave, and so he never used it actually, but it was used after the war in the 1950s for the researchers that were carried out here in Padua on cosmic rays, and later for the cryophysics researchers that were carried out in Padua. At the time it was built in the 1930s, it was really regarded as a jewel of technology. It was very, very powerful one. It was made of similar to the ones that were used by Blackett in England, and this was particularly good. Instruments that are here, we have only part of the collection displayed here. And it is not really a real museum, it is sort of open storage. But we should have a new place to organize a better display. And to also to show many of the instruments we have in the storerooms, because the collection is really huge. So all you will see, so when we go through the museum, all the parts of physics are in the collection. There are also instruments of mathematics and drawing. There is, of course, hydrostatics, mechanics, pneumatics, you will see, optics, and then in the other rooms you will see also electricity, meteorology, I mean, of course. So what you are looking at now is the portrait of Giovanni Polanyi. So Polanyi was the first professor of experimental physics. You know that, of course, Galileo set up his experimental method in the 17th century. But in the universities, natural philosophy was still taught on the basis of Aristotle texts for a long time. So things really started to change in a very important way from the beginning of the 18th century. From that time, in the universities also, throughout Europe, in the universities, lectures were started to be proposed based on experiments and demonstrations. So these new courses were called of experimental philosophy or experimental physics, and in Padua the chair was created, so this new chair was created in 1738, and in 1739 it was assigned to Giovanni Polanyi. So Polanyi was He was already a professor at the university. He had taught astronomy, he had taught mathematics and natural philosophy, but on a theoretical way. But he was from Venice, and already when he was young, in from the early 18th century in Venice, he had started making experiments, demonstrations. He loved it very much, and he was regarded as an expert at the European level, an expert of instruments. So when the new chair was created in the university, they asked Polanyi to become the new professor. And what he did, we have found all the letters about it. What he did, he he asked the authorities of the universities, at that time you know that Padua was ruled by Venice. So the authorities of the universities were the members of the Venetian Senate, of the Senate of the Republic of Venice. And Polanyi asked them, well, I have to make demonstrations, I need an assistant, I need a place where to give these lectures, because usually, you know, the lectures at the university at that time were often given at home by the professors, but Polanyi said, no, here I have to make demonstrations, I need a real place, and I need money, because I have to buy instruments, and instruments were expensive, it was difficult to find them. So the Venetian authorities gave him everything. So they started, Polanyi started a sort of to restructure the Palazzo del Po, which I hope you will see this afternoon, the historical building of the university, to have a theater for 100 persons to give his lectures. And he got money. So this one of the first publicly founded collections of cabinet of physics in Europe within a university. And so here is the collection. Of course, all of his successors went on enriching it and buying new instruments according to what was needed. So this is what you can see here. Immediate demonstrations of the laws of physics. So for instance, of course, to show the parabolic motion of projectiles, you just have a ball rolling down and the parabola is already designed and you have a direct demonstration of this. This instrument was used to show the tautochronism of the cycloid, which was a propriety. You cut the instruments according to a cycloid, and then if you have two balls falling down from two different points at the same moment, they arrive down always at the same time, which is a property of the cycloid. And why was it a classical instrument? It is a property which we do not longer really study, but why was it a classical instrument in the 18th century cabinet of physics? Because it was connected to the studies on pendulums. If you could have a pendulum describe a cycloid, then it would be isochronic, because independent the period independent of the amplitude of oscillation. So this was an instrument used to show this property of the cycloid. This was used to show the parabolic motion of liquids. It was filled with mercury. You could change the angle, open, and you could see the parabolic trajectories of motion of liquids. These, of course, to study forces. These were used to study the conservation laws. In particular the conservation of MV. Also one important thing too, Polanyi bought instruments, some instruments from Nollet, the famous Nollet in Paris. He bought some instruments from Marschenbroek in Leiden. But the main part of his collection was made locally. He had craftsmen working for him, and he based his designs on the books, the textbooks of the time. So, so for instance, here you have, so yes, also one typical feature of the 18th century experimental physics lessons, the wheel that goes up instead of going down. And of course this was, because the idea of these lessons was to catch the attention, be surprising, spectacular, but then everything had to be explained. And so of course the wheel goes up, but then you show that there is a lead cylinder inserted, so you start, you surprise your public, but then you start discussing about barycenter. So this was the idea. So you always started with an experiment and then you explained. Mm-hmm. So this was the idea, which I think worked very, very well, in fact. Physics was extraordinarily popular in the 18th century. Mm-hmm. Double cone, you know it probably. So the double cone, which this one is not working very well because it was broken. But instead of going down, it goes up. So it seems surprising, but in fact, for the way it is built, the barycenter, when the instrument seems to go up, in reality, in fact, the barycenter is going down. So it is perfectly. So here again, it's like the wheel. It was to explain the barycenter property. Testing instrument, the Tantalus cups. You just start pouring down liquid in the cups, and nothing happens at the beginning until the liquid reaches almost the edge of the cup, and then it starts coming down from the little holes down, and you can never fill the cup. It's impossible. You can go pouring. No, it will always come down and empty. Because, and this, so this was to start the lesson. And then why? Because inside is inserted a siphon. So when the siphon starts to work. So this was a possible starting point to talk about atmospheric pressure, siphons, etc. Professors, all in the 18th century, also bought some older instruments for teaching, which are now exceptional, outstanding instruments for themselves. I mean, this is an astrolabe which is signed Renerus Arsenius, 1566, and it is the only astrolabe where made by Arsenio, where the edge, usually the edge of the astrolabes of Arsenius are coincide with the Tropic of the Capricorn. And here the Tropic of the Capricorn is a little bit inside, so everything outside the tropic is south of the tropic. And this is a unique piece in this sense. So it is of incredible value. It's very, very important. And but it was bought at the time simply for teaching physics. And now we have some outstanding 16th century instruments. The same for this armillary sphere, which is from the 16th century too, and it is three armillary spheres, one into the other, to show what was the 8th, 9th and 10th sphere of the Ptolemaic system. And these are, such armillary spheres are very rare. There are six or seven of them throughout the world. So it's very important now. And it's good because when we do the guided visits, we can start from what was the situation of the studies on nature in the 16th century. So there were practical mathematical instruments. Then the scientific revolution with Galileo, we can tell this to the students. Then the scientific instruments with Galileo, and then the new physics, experimental physics lessons, and new scientific method and so on. So it's good to have these very old instruments, it's very interesting. Now, coming back to the 18th century physics courses, another feature of them is that they had models of machines where the laws of physics were applied. So this was a pile driver, which was used for constructing bridges. So you have the mass here, the heavy mass, which is lifted and then left down, it falls down, and it was used to pile down the piles into the river to construct the bridges. Now, this one is a little bit special because it was moved by the water itself. And it was designed by Bartolomeo Ferracina, who was a mechanic, clockmaker. He restored the San Marco clock in Venice. He is also the one who restored the Palazzo della Ragione. When you go to the center of Padua, maybe if we have time I will show you to you, or you can find it. It is a big, very old 13th century building in the center of the city. And in the mid-18th century, it was the roof of it was partly destroyed, so Bartolomeo Ferracina restored it, and he made a meridian in it. If you go in it, it is worth getting in. It is really beautiful, and inside you will find a meridian, sundial, which was made and signed Bartolomeo Ferracina Feci. So Bartolomeo Ferracina was also in charge of remaking a bridge in the 18th century. It is a very important bridge in Italy because it is the bridge of Bassano, which had been designed by Palladio. So in the mid-18th century, the bridge was taken out, was destroyed by a flood, and Ferracina was in charge of rebuilding it, and for this he designed this pile driver, and then he made this model, this small scale model, for the cabinet of physics, because the experimental physicists were very interested also in what happened around. So what I always try to show is that really, when you have a physics collection like this, it not only talks you about the history of physics or the history of teaching in this university, but also about the history of the territory, about the way the physicists of that time were related to society. It is about the history of architecture as well, because this was used to rebuild a very important bridge in Italy. So there are so many ways of reading such instruments, and they are totally fascinating. Models of machines went on for during also the 19th century, and this is something that is always fascinating for the kids who come, because of course it's a model of a steam engine, which was used for a tobacco factory. So these were the things that were used to prepare the tobacco, just to, I don't know how to pile it down. And of course the scientific technical important part is this one, so the steam engine. And this one, here you can talk a lot about the history of steam engines. This one includes several of the improvements of the patents that were obtained by James Watt. Because before him, machines were only, you know, they were atmospheric steam engines, where the atmospheric pressure brought down the piston. Here it is a double effect machine, so the steam is used both to bring down the piston and to bring it up inside here. There is a separate condenser so that the condensation of the steam takes place separately from the cylinder, which is also something new for the time. And here parallelogram to distribute, to change, transform the motion into circular motion, and then very famous, the centrifugal regulator. You know, you see that it is connected to the machine itself. If the machine worked with too much power, and it could become dangerous, of course, this turned more and more quickly, so the two spheres went up, and automatically you had the entrance of the steam partially or totally closed. So this is the very first example of feedback in a machine. It is a first regulator. And what I also underline when the young people come is that, because usually, you know, people say, oh yes, there is the theory and then the application. But in the case of the steam engines, when Watt worked on them, they barely knew something about latent calore latente, and that's all. So it was the success of steam engines which brought the interest to study them and brought the birth of thermodynamics in the 19th century. So it's very interesting to talk about this with the visitors and to show them this. So this is another way also to read such history. So we go a gesture. So a steam, you know, which are now used for cooking. And it was bought by Polanyi in the Netherlands. And it was 42 kilograms in the mid 18th century, and it was bought here, brought here. With all the typical instruments of optics, mirrors, lenses, instruments connected with polarization, spectroscopy, some microscopes. There are also some sundials there, instruments where optics are applied, so microscope, telescopes, magic lantern, which was really the first, the ancestor of the projector. So, if you, and also drawing the anamorphosis drawing. So these are the mirrors with, you see the images here is deformata, and you can see it right in the mirror. Different kind of mirrors. This is a camera optica, camera oscura. Yes. From the mid 18th century. It seems that Canaletto, who is the famous Venetian painter, he used a camera optica for several of his Venetian drawings. This is Eliostat, which was used to have light in the laboratories to study, to make optical experiments. And so you had a mirror outside, and you had a mirror, and the light was just brought into the laboratory, a clock system, so that you could follow the sun and always have your beam of light to work with. This is a refractometer, which was, so here is the entrance of the light beam here. If you come from this side, you can see it. And then they put water or other liquids in it, and they studied the refraction in different liquids. So then, so the light came in here, then it was, of course, refracted, and you just moved this arm in order to have the light beam on this point, and you just then read the angle, and you had the information on the refraction. These are sundials of different kinds, so portable sundials. You just that can be folded up, and you could really have them in your pocket. Yes, it was really the way to read time. This is very important. It is a microscope which is signed here, Eustachio Divini, Roma, 1671, and it is the only, it is a very unique model, because usually 17th century microscopes are quite small, are much smaller, something like this. This one is huge. It can, when it is totally open, it comes this height. And it is very important because it is signed Eustachio Divini, who was a very well-known optic maker in at that time. He was known throughout Europe. And this is the, it is a unique instrument because of the signature and because of the model, it is regarded as very important. And then here are the microscopes and Mohs resonators, phonograph. That I prefer in the collection, because it works this way. You have, so here, resonators that are connected to a small thing like this, which is separated, which is a small thing with a membrane in it. So if the sound contains a certain note, the corresponding resonator will resonate, and the corresponding membrane will vibrate. Then, what do you do? You open, you lit a flame here. There was a gas supply, so you had the flames all here, and you made the mirror turn. So what happened? If the sound contains a certain note, the corresponding flame will tremble. And when you turn the mirror, you will see the flames in the mirror as because there is permanence of the permanence on the retina, you will, there is the effect. So you will see the flames as things like this. And if the sound contains a certain note, the corresponding flame trembles, so you will see something like this, otherwise smooth. So you are changing the sound into an image. It was very, very interesting, isn't it? This is fascinating, I think. And we are in the 1870s. It is connected to the words of Helmholtz on the perception and things like this. So it is a very interesting instrument. These are Chladni figures. You just put on them some sand and make them vibrate. These are the meteorological instruments. So can you see here? They are very not well displayed. I mean, it's too many. This one is a very important piece, a unique piece also. Because you can see it is a thermometer universel. It was a universal thermometer. Why? Because you know that in the, there was a rush in the 18th century to get something, what we would call a standard thermometer, that could be compared, that could be easily reproduced, and that could be reliable. But there were several problems. One of the problems was, what fixed points are reliable? What are the ones that we could use? What is the best thermometric liquid? So several problems. So everybody tried to do a thermometer. Newton tried to do a thermometer with lin oil. There were thermometers made with olive oil, with of course there were alcohol, mercury, etc. And they tried all kind of fixed points. They tried of course the boiling point of water, but also the fusion point of of woks, the fusion point of butter, they tried everything. It was really trying because, and so there were in the 18th century something like more than 30 different thermometric scales that were proposed. And here in this thermometer, the inventor of this thermometer, Michele Ducrest, made a comparison. He was one of the first to make a quantitative comparison between the different scales that there were at that time. And if you see, look, there is the scale of Monsieur Newton, Réaumur, etc. There are 8 thermometric scales in this thermometer in parallel. So it's there are 2 other thermometers like this in Germany, but very, very damaged. This is a really unique piece also. And a curiosity, here you have a 0 degree in this scale, which is wrote tempéré, but the water in ice is 10 degrees under the tempéré, under the zero. So what was this universal, the 0 point? It was because people at that time also tried as fixed points underground places, caves, grottoes, because the temperature was stable. And so this 0 point was the temperature of the undergrounds of the Paris Observatory, so which was chosen as a universal point. So, okay. So this is always meteorology, the barometers and thermometers of different kind. This was to show Galileo law of for falling bodies. So you have all the tours. This one is bigger than this, so which grow according to the number 1, 3, 5, 7. So this is 5 times this one, this is 7 times, and so on. So when you have a ball left to fall down throughout here, it will go through every tour always in the same period of time according to Galileo's law of falling. And this was so, even in this big one, it will just go through it exactly in the same time as this one. It was really devised to give a direct demonstration of Galileo motion force. Here, balances, and in, this one was used and devised to study the momentum delle forze. And this is room of electricity. When the students have come, we have these computers, we show PowerPoint, explain things, mm-hmm. and to show them, for instance, how electricity was practiced in the 18th century and so on. So here you go through the history of electricity with the instruments. So in the early 18th century, from the 1740s actually, electrostatic generators were produced. So a cylinder or flow which was made turn, and there was here a cushion, or you used hands, and the electricity was collected on these electric collectors, and then you made sparks, and they tried to understand what electricity was. Also, in the mid-18th century, a very important experiment was achieved, the Leyden experiment. So from that time, the research on electricity totally changed, because they rediscussed it led to the ideas of capacity and so on. And Leyden bottles, so the condensators, were no more with water in them, but metal leaves inside and outside the bottles. So these are from the early 19th century. This is an electroforo devised by Volta. You know the instrument? It was, so there is a resin plate which you just rubbed, so it charged negatively. Then you put on it the metallic plate, and you put your hand on it like this, and so the negative charges go down to the earth, and the plate remains charged positively. When you take it up, you can use it to have it, to charge something. It is positive. But the resina has not lost its charge, so you can do it again and again and again. So Volta, who was the inventor of this, he was very happy. He called it electroforo perpetuo, because he was... but it is very interesting, because it had... in the 18th century, there were doublers of electricity which were done on the basis of the electroforo. But from the second half of the 19th century, the idea of the electroforo was taken up in all the electrostatic induction generators, until to the Wimshurst machines and so on. They are based on the idea of the electroforo. And this is a very funny instrument, which was used to... You have an electroforo down there, here you had a metal and an acid falling down, so that hydrogen was produced. And you just pull this little thing, and when you pull it, the little rope, what happens? The gas is allowed to pour out between the two electrodes, and at the same time the plate of the electroforo is lifted up, so that there is a spark between the two electrodes, there is hydrogen in between, and so you have a flame. Okay? Mm-hmm. At the same time also the candle is made to go down, and so it was a way to light a candle. It was an automatic way to light a candle. A little bit complicated, but it's funny. Here are all the instruments related to electrostatics, so all kind of electrostatic experiments, the electroscopes and so on. And then of course the invention of, with the very, very beginning of the 19th century, the invention of the battery by Alessandro Volta. So from this moment onwards, electrodynamics starts. So here you have several examples of different kind of batteries. This is quite unusual, because it is these are dry batteries which were designed by a scientist working in Verona, Zamboni, who devised these batteries. You do not put in between, you know, you always put some paper or tissue with acid, no, in the battery. And here, no, they just used the humidity of the air. But the metals were chosen in such a way that they gave a very low intensity current, but a good tension. And especially what was interesting, they lasted for years. So here you have two of these batteries with a plus and a minus there, okay? And the little pendulum was thus attracted, and then he went up and down. He was attracted and respinto, and he went up and down, and the device worked from October, you see the date, October 1830. It worked until the time when the collection was moved from the Palazzo del Bo, the historical building you will see in the center of Padua, to the new buildings that were made here, the new Institute of Physics. During the transport, you see here, the battery was broken, so it doesn't work any longer. But there are models of this kind in Oxford, made in the 1840s, which still work it's amazing. It's really amazing. So, action between the action of a current on the needle of a compass, the sort of interactions between electricity and magnetism, the physicists found an interesting way to measure the intensity of electric current. They had a solenoid and they put a compass inside, a magnetic needle inside, and they could measure the intensity of the current. But these ones are special because they were designed by Leopoldo Nobili, who was a scientist in Reggio Emilia here in Italy. And he put not only one needle inside the solenoid, but he put a system made of two needles in this way, so that in opposite directions, so that the whole system was less sensitive to the magnetic field of the Earth. But one of the needles was inside the solenoid, the other one was outside, and so the action of the current was reinforced. And so these galvanometers were extremely, extremely sensitive. And it was really a big change in the 1820, around 1825. And so this one in particular was sent directly from Nobili, the inventor, to the professor of physics here in Padua. And then these instruments were made by makers throughout Europe. And so they became very popular, but this one was really made by the inventor. So this we are very happy. And we have many instruments in the museum which are made by the inventor. This one was the Zamboni model, this one. These were also made by Zamboni. It was a sort of a compact kit with all the electromagnetic experiments you can do at the time. So Barlow's wheel, Ampere circuits and so on. So, we have, for instance, an induction coil made by Hunkoff himself, and so on. Here is also interesting. Well, this is about electrical discharges in gases. Do you know the history of electrical discharges in gases? So, at first, it was discovered at the end of the 17th century that when you move a barometer in the dark, you have some colors above, which was related to the fact that there are instead of having sparks, because there is a rarefied air on the top of the mercury column, you have these colors. So in the laboratories in the 19th century, you started having some of these eggs. You have a discharge between the two electrodes, but if you connect the instrument with a pneumatic pump, you have rarefied gas inside, and instead of having a white spark, you have colored, very nice colors all around. So this was studied for a while. Gases were studied for a long while because they were spectacular, beautiful lights. Then little by little, the turning point was in the mid-19th century with new pneumatic, with new air pumps, with mercury. We will see a model in the other room. And higher voltages with induction coils and so on. And so Geissler, for instance, started making these Geissler tubes, which are like the electrical egg, but with a lower pressure. And then they started observing new things. And so the fact that there were not always these colors, but if the pressure was low enough, the tube was opaque and there were only green, the glass itself became green. I mean, all this led to the discovery of X-rays, and then from X-rays to radioactivity and the electron. So
all these showcases are about this. These are all different kinds of X-ray tubes, all different from one another. And you know that Röntgen wrote his article at the end of December 1895, and these are diapositives from X-rays, which are dated, if you look at them, 1618, January 1896. So about a couple of weeks after Röntgen's discovery. So, of course, it's very important. But it also shows that all the laboratories were equipped with, they had induction coils, they had discharge tubes. So as soon as Röntgen published his paper, everyone was able to make X-ray, in fact. So it, because it was already a field that people were working on. Here you have an electrical motor. And here the new ways of producing electricity. So induction coil to get higher voltages with its Foucault interrupter. The magnetoelectric generator to coils moving into a magnetic field. This one also, coils moving in a magnetic field to create current. And this is also another instrument, for instance, just to give you an idea, this is signed Störer Leipzig, and he was the inventor of this model. The same with this dynamo here. So here you have coils down, moving in a magnetic field, but created by an electromagnet. So it's the very first, one of the very first models of dynamo. It was devised in about 1867, if I'm not wrong. And the inventor of this model is William Led, London. So he is also the maker of this one. So it's very important, of course. And then these are electrostatic induction generator of the second half of the 19th century. And then the applications of electricity, telephones, telegraphs, the electric arc, and radiant, calore radiante, and so on. And then we have another room, which is the pneumatics room, but I will show you something, this is very narrow, of also the 20th century physics that we have. As I said, Bruno Rossi was teacher here, and we said that he had, you saw the electromagnet outside. He is the one who devised, who planned and built the Institute of Physics there. And he had planned, as I told you, an accelerator. So this is one of the deals of the accelerator he had devised. So from the 1937. He worked on cosmic rays. So to work on cosmic rays, he had also prepared this one, which was a cloud chamber. Also this one, he couldn't use it because as soon as it was ready, he had to leave. So people used it after the war to study cosmic rays. And this one also, something that he used, Geiger counters with this support, because there was the idea, what are cosmic rays when they enter the atmospheres? This was, there was a big problem at that time. And Rossi suggested that it would be interesting to study the different intensities of the different, according to the intensity of the coming cosmic rays according to the direction they come from, because Millikan said they are photons, but some people, Compton, but also Bruno Rossi, started thinking that they could be charged particles. So, if they are charged particles, that they will be deviated by the magnetic field of the Earth, and so locally you will have different intensities, more from the west or from the east, according if they are negative or positive particles. And so Bruno Rossi devised this instrument, so he put Geiger counters here and there, and he could just measure, change all the angles he wanted to measure. And this is the original article, one of the articles where he says that he used this device. He went in Eritrea, in Africa, to carry out the experiments, because the more close to the equator. These are instruments related to the study of radioactivity, for instance, so very sensitive electrometers, different kinds of them. And this is also interesting. Bubble chambers were invented in the United States in 1952. Pietro Bassi, who was a scientist, was a physicist here, young physicist at the time here, he went for 1 year in the United States and he learned about this in 1952-1953, and he came back and he wanted to make bubble chambers here in Padua. And so these are the first prototypes he made, and with this one, this was the first bubble chamber which successfully worked in Europe. So the first photograph of a cosmic ray with a bubble chamber, in Europe is this one. It was made in 1954. And then the team went on working with bubble chambers, and they made this one, little bit big one, a propane bubble chamber. This one was used at SC at CERN in 1958. It was the first bubble chamber used at CERN in Geneva. So this one also is interesting.
We don't have much interactive place in the museum because we do not have room. And also because we do not want to teach physics, but we want to teach the history of physics. And so, but we have these experiments, for instance, here, because these were the, you know, you can hear the sound, but then you create vacuum, so the balloon inflates and things. Because these were experiments that were already achieved in the 17th and 18th century to show, so these are here to show how physics was practiced in the past. And we have the original air pumps. So for instance, this one, which dates back from the early 18th century. So here is the place where the experiments took place. Two cylinders, like a syringe, really. You just take out the air from from here. And these are different models of air pumps. This one is only one cylinder. Here was the plate with the campana for the experiments, and the piston went up and down, forward and backwards to rarefy the air here. And other instruments, for instance, this one related always to pressure and rarefy the air and compression. This one was, you put water here, and then this is a compression pump, this is from the 18th century, and you compress the air contained here, then you take out this one, you open here, and because the air is compressed, the water comes out very high. So these are typical 18th century experiments again. This one also is very, very funny. It was a hero fountain. You just put in a liquid. So there is liquid in both vases here. You put in another liquid. Polanyi in the 18th century says he used wine. So he put in, no, what he said is this. He put in water
and you had a high jet of wine because the wine was inside, and then you put in the water, you change the pressures, and the wine was filled up. So it was a way of transforming water in wine. You know what? We have done a cocktail.